Hi, welcome back to my channel. This is the final chapter of my series on musical set theory. In previous videos, I have explained the basics of this theory and briefly discussed how it's used in music analysis. However, nothing I've said so far explains why I use it. I certainly don't use it for analysis, so why do I find it useful in my composition process? Before going into that, I have an announcement to make. I'm going to be teaching more hours this semester than I used to, so I just won't have the time to do 2 videos a month. I also need to have free hours to compose and have a life, you know? So from now on, I'll only post 1 video at the end of each month. I'm sorry I have to do this, but if I don't, I'll go crazy. Let's continue with our topic. I want to begin by pointing out some premises related to the application of set theory to composition. First, it's preferable to choose a finite number of sets to work with. Using the entire catalog is not only complicated, and impossible, I think, but offers little chance of providing a consistent result. If you're going to use more than one set, it makes sense to start by studying what each of them sounds like and how they relate to each other. I'll show you how I approach this issue in a moment. Sets can be used in different ways. There are no rules related to the repetition of elements. In fact, there are no rules of any kind. In a way, working with sets is like working with chords or scales in tonal music, only there are no guidelines that control the transition from one set to the next. We have to follow our intuition and use some tools like the ones I'm about to show you. For instance, you don't have to use the notes of a set simultaneously. You can do it one by one, 2x2, 3x3, or in dissimilar groups, 1, 3, 2, 5, etc. You also don't have to use their notes in a specific order, and there is no center, no root, no dominant, no leading tone, etc. Regarding the way to choose the sets to use, this can be done in a totally arbitrary way, or you can select sets known to have specific properties, such as the all-interval tetrachords. It's also possible to start from other pieces and use, for example, the Tristan chord or a group of chords taken from any other work and writing them as sets. Set theory accepts groups of any number of notes, from 1 to 12, as valid as any other, so it gives much more freedom of choice than the tonal system, while being at the same time a kind of system. This ensures a certain degree of consistency in the result, something desirable in musical composition. Finally, set theory allows us to use techniques for modifying the musical material that are not available in the tonal system, mainly mathematical procedures. Now, if you're not very fond of mathematics, this may not be very attractive, but some composers are, and for them, set theory provides a way to apply mathematical concepts and operations to musical composition. So, why do I use set theory to compose? What do I find useful in it? The first reason is mainly psychological. When I'm working on a piece and decide to use, say, set 735 transposed to PC2, I see nothing but a bunch of numbers, especially now that I've trained myself to stop using the names of the notes and call them simply by a number. Set 735 transposed to PC2 is actually the E-flat major scale, and I might be aware of it to some extent, but that's in the back of my mind. In the foreground, what I see are just numbers, all of them equally important. As I said before, there is no root, no dominant, no leading tone, no specific order of elements, no triads, nothing. I have effectively stripped the E-flat major scale of all the typical connotations associated with tonal music, and this gives me much more freedom in how I use it. I know this may sound unbelievable. How can you play with the notes of the E-flat major scale and not be aware of it? Well, trust me, it works, especially after you've spent so much time working with this theory that you no longer refer to the notes by their traditional names, but by numbers. Secondly, set theory provides me with a classification system, a way of ciphering the harmonic elements in my works, much like the chord symbols in tonal music. Then I can give those elements a specific name. They become more concrete, so to speak. I can assign them certain properties and characteristics and include them in a personal catalog of musical objects from which I can choose the ones that suit my needs at any given moment in a composition. All of the above provides me with a way to ensure harmonic unity throughout a piece. I'm no longer finding my way with my eyes closed, relying solely on my intuition. Instead, I know exactly what I'm doing. I have a series of building blocks. I know their characteristics and how they relate to each other, so I can use them objectively without fear of losing harmonic consistency. The next reason is purely practical. If I include forte names in my score, that's what we call ciphers in set theory, like 641 and 735. Then, if I want to make changes to the music later on, I have a way of knowing exactly which collection of pitches I was using in any given measure. Of course, I could also extract this information from the music itself, but using the forte names is much easier. On the other hand, it is also true that I could simply make changes by following nothing more than my own intuition and taste in music. Who will notice that I used a note that wasn't part of the original set, right? Well, I will. Music is a form of organization, and if I choose a particular system for that, I want to stick to it. Otherwise, what's the point? Also, we composers have some pride, you know? And we place great importance on being organized and consistent. We see it as a sign of professionalism. In line with the above, using forte names also helps me if I'm writing a reduction that I plan to orchestrate later, as it often happens that, when orchestrating, I end up adding extra lines that weren't in the reduction. Finally, the use of set theory gives me the opportunity to create a personal catalog of harmonic objects that I can use over and over again in various works. This then allows me to achieve a certain consistency in the musical language throughout several pieces, at least from a harmonic point of view, which helps me to define a personal harmonic style. In my case, for example, I tend a lot to diatonicism. Chromaticism is something I use sparingly, and excessive dissonance is not a typical feature of my music. Therefore, I tend to use mainly the set complex of 735, that is, set 735 itself, the diatonic scale, and all the other sets related to it, such as 632, the terzo hexachord, 535, the pentatonic scale, etc. I only use a few sets outside of this set complex, such as 734 and 828. Which sets you end up using is up to you. My advice is to limit yourself to a few, and even better if you choose them in such a way that there are similarity relations between them. A few minutes ago, I mentioned that one should study how each set sounds, and when using more than one, how they relate to each other. There are two ways you can do this. The first is to create what I call a map, a graph of some sort, like a mind map, where you write down the sets and connect them using lines, arrows, dashed boxes, etc. You can use forte similarity relations that I described in my previous video. It's also a good idea to write down the interval vectors. The goal is to understand how all of these sets are related to each other, which is a subset or superset of which differ by only one or two interval vector entries, and so on. This is the map I created for a piece I wrote a few years ago. I don't always use maps, and to be honest, I don't think they are very helpful for me. But they might be for you, so I think you should try this approach, even if you end up discarding it afterwards. What does help me is creating what I call a color table, or color study. In tonal music, we know in advance the color of each chord type, in other words, how they sound. But this is not the case when sets are used, unless they correspond to the chords of the tonal system, of course. If I tell you, imagine the sound of a major chord, surely you can do it without problem. But if I say to you, imagine the sound of the all-interval tetrachords, unless you are very familiar with them, or if you have perfect pitch, you'll be completely blank. Therefore, it's a good idea to make a kind of table, where you can describe in your own terms the way you perceive each set. I tend to do this harmonically, in other words, writing the notes of the set as a chord and progressively changing the lowest note to see how that affects the sound of the set. You can also do it horizontally, playing the notes as a scale, starting on a different note each time, like playing the modes of the diatonic scale. You can write the result as adjectives, like bright, dark, neutral, etc., and also use colors. The idea here is to have a table from which you can easily find which set to use according to your expressive needs. This is the table of my piece, Images of the Peruvian Coast. As you can see, I used multiple sets, something I ended up regretting, so don't follow my lead or you'll have a hard time. I classified the sets into four colors: radiant, clear, neutral, dark, and somber. The columns on the right correspond to the rotation of the pieces within each set, and as you may have already noticed, some sets dramatically change color depending on which note is used as the bass or first when played as a scale. In my previous video, I showed you an online application that I use called the PC Set Calculator. It was programmed by someone named David Walters in 2001, at the time a fourth-year student at Mount Allison University in Sackville, Canada. There's a link below that opens a window that very briefly explains how to use it. To enter a set, simply click on the keyboard or check the boxes below the keys. You can also enter PCs by typing them in the first field, separated by spaces. You mustn't use commas, and you must use the letters T and E for PCs 10 and 11. Once you've entered the PCs, press Submit or Enter on your keyboard. The app will then display the forte name of the PC set formed by those PCs. It will also display the prime form of that PC set and the normal form. That is, it will arrange the PCs that you have entered to match the order of the PCs in the prime form. This is what gives you the transposition of the set. The first number of the normal form corresponds to the PC to which the set has been transposed. The app gives you the interval vector and the Z-mate, if there's any. You can also use it to find subsets and supersets, as well as a complement. Unfortunately, the app doesn't give you the prime form of the set's inversion. It shows the inversion, as you can see here, but this is obviously not in prime form. However, this is easy to solve. Simply transpose the inversion to the value of the last PC of the prime form. So, for example, if we enter PCs 0, 3, and 7, we get the forte name 311, which corresponds to the minor chord. The inversion of this PC set is 047, the major chord, but here we get 590. If we now use the drop-down menu to transpose this result to PC7, we get 047, which is indeed what we expected. Finally, you can also use the app to create a matrix, which works exactly like a 12-tone matrix, only it's a 9x9 matrix instead of a 12x12. This is part of the score of my piece Symphony for Piano Quintet, which I have already discussed in another series. Here you can see how I use Dorico's comment function to write the forte names of the sets I'm using. Right next to them, in parentheses, I write the PC to which the prime form has been transposed, the first PC of the normal form. This particular passage actually shows an additional advantage of using set theory to compose. This is a variation of a previous section, but with all the sets transposed by a certain value. I wanted to keep the same progression, but write different lines on each instrument. So instead of having to go back and forth to check the original passage and mentally transpose the pitches, I simply copied the set progression from the original passage and used the PC set calculator to transpose them. Then all I had to do was use that information to create this new passage. This simplified the entire process. This is the end of my series on musical set theory. I hope you found it interesting and, above all, useful. I'm still deciding what topic I want to cover next. See you in a month with a new video. Until then, take care. Ciao.